about roster method and set builder method of representing a set, right? That's what we're talking about. So today we're going to talk about different types of sets. Okay, how many types of sets are there, and we'll discuss them one by one. Okay, so the first we're going to discuss is empty set. You see, as the name suggests, empty set is a set that contains no elements at all. There are no elements in this set. That's why it is called empty set. Okay. And empty set is otherwise called a null set or void set. Okay. But most preferably, you will call it empty set. Most of the time, we call it empty set. But you can also call it null set or void set as well. So let me give you an example of an empty set. Suppose there is a set A, which is A is equal to set of students of both class, set of students studying in both class 10 and 11. Okay. Now let's talk about the kinds of elements that are there in this set. What kind of elements are there in this set? Or what are the elements of this set A? The elements are all the students who study in both class 10 and 11. But the problem is no such student exists who studies in both class until class 10 and 11. That means finding a student like this is impossible, right? Such a student does not exist. It's an impossible student, right? Such a student doesn't exist. That means there is no such element which you can put in set A. So set A is simply an empty set. Okay, it has no elements in it. So I will write this set A as this. Just curly braces, and within those curly braces, nothing. Okay, this is a way of denoting set, empty set. Okay, symbolically you can denote empty set by phi. Symbolically you will denote empty set by phi. Okay, so remember, empty set is denoted by this in these two ways. Okay, wherever this symbol is written phi, it means empty set. Okay, it is a set which carries no element at all. Also, in some places, instead of phi, they would use this. Okay. Also, this means this is a set which carries no elements at all. So this is symbol for empty set. Okay, I hope you got it. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay, let's move on. Okay. So this was all about empty set. Now we shall talk about the set builder method of writing an empty set. Now, how do we write an empty set in set builder method? You see, I will write empty set in set builder method like this. X is such that X is not equal to X. Don't worry about it, I'll explain it to you. This is the set builder method of empty set, universal set builder method of empty set. You see, how will you know? Suppose I have not written phi here, and I just gave you this. And my question is, will you be able to find out that yes, this is an empty set? Absolutely yes, this is an empty set. How? You see, let's talk about the element of this set. X here represents all the elements of this set. Okay, whatever elements it carries, X represents all those elements, right? Yesterday we talked about this. X is representing each and every element of whatever this set is. Okay. Then after this colon symbol, this such that, we write the property of the elements, right? Unique common property. And what is the unique common property of the elements of this set? That the elements are not equal to themselves. If X is any random element of this set, which it is, then X is not equal to X. It means, if X is any random element of this set, that element is not equal to itself. And this is an impossible event. Okay, it is impossible because we know it that everything is equal to itself. Everything is equal to itself. So you won't be able to find such an x which is not equal to itself. That means this set is empty. Got it? So this is the set builder method of representing empty set. I hope you got it.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, let me erase it.
Yes, sir.
Let me erase it. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now let's talk about finite set. And yes, those who are completely newcomers, don't you worry about it. Yes.
No, sir.
Okay. You see all these videos are available on my channel. I have explained these things in greatest detail possible. So you watch those videos. All of your confusions and doubts will be clear. And wherever you incur any doubts, you just call me right away. Okay. So let's talk about finite set and infinite set right now. Okay. You see, what is a finite set? Okay. You see, a finite set is a set that carries finite number of elements. Finite number of element means you can count the number of elements. For example, let me write a set here. You see here, you know that this set contains three elements because you can count those elements, right? There are three elements in it. Suppose I write another set 1, 2, 3 dot 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 dot. This is also a finite set because you can count the number of elements. There are 1 lakh elements in this set. Obviously, you can count it. Okay. Now, let me give you another example. Empty set. You see, empty set is also a finite set. Why? Because you can count the number of elements in it. And you counted and you say there are 0 number of elements in it. Right? Obviously, you can count the number of an empty set. How many elements are there in empty set? 0. Number of elements in empty set is 0. That means you can easily count the number of elements of empty set, right? Number of elements in empty set is equal to 0. You can count, right? So empty set is also a finite set. Okay. So I can say any set that carries a definite number of elements is an empty set and is a finite set, and empty set is also a finite set. Remember, an empty set or any set that carries a definite number of elements is called a finite set. I hope you got it, right? Finite set. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So basically, if you can count the number of elements, then it is finite set, okay? And empty set is also a finite set because you can count the number of elements in it, right? Then let's talk about an infinite set. Infinite set. You see, a set which carries an infinite number of elements in it is called an infinite set. That means you cannot count the number of elements in it. There are uncountable number of elements in it. For example, set of natural numbers. How many elements are there in it? You see, infinite number of elements are there in it. There is no last natural number. Any natural number give you, no matter how big it is, you just add 1 to it, you will get the next natural number. So it is an infinite set because you cannot count the number of elements in it, right? Set of real numbers, it is an infinite set. Set of integers is an infinite set. Set of rational numbers, infinite set. Set of irrational numbers, infinite set. Okay, I hope you got the gist, okay? Set of all prime numbers, infinite set. Because obviously, how many prime numbers are there? Infinite number of prime numbers are there. Can you tell me what the last prime number is? No. Okay, the infinite number of prime numbers are there. Set of composite numbers, also infinite set. Got it? Okay. So let's move on. Okay. Now let's talk about order or cardinality or modulus of a finite set. Okay, you see these three are the same thing. Order or cardinality or modulus, they are the same thing. of a finite set. You see, finite set has a finite number of elements in it. We already know, we can count the number of elements, right? Let's say A is a set which has elements 1, 2, 3, so we can count the number of elements in it. Now order of set A or cardinality of set A or modulus of set A is equal to the number of elements set A has. You see, you just have to count the number of elements. You see, how many elements are there in set A? 3, right? There are 3 elements in set A. So we will say that order
yes,
of
sir.
Yes. So we'll say that order of set A is equal to 3. Or you can say cardinality of set A is equal to 3. Or you can say modulus of set A is equal to 3. Simply all these three phrases, they mean number of elements of set A. Okay. And symbolically, how do we write? Let me erase it. Got it, everybody? Clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now symbolically, how do I write it? You see, set A has 3 elements, let's say 1, 2, 3. Then I will write n of a. Okay, small n, then within this parenthesis I write A. Okay, n of A is equal to 3. That means number of elements of set A is equal to 3. Or you can also write it like this, mod of A or modulus of A is equal to 3. You see here, do not confuse this modulus with the modulus of real numbers. Okay, that is different. Modulus of real numbers is different and modulus of set is different. Set is not a real number, set is a different thing. Okay, entirely different thing. It is a collection and everything, we know it. Okay, so do not confuse this modulus with that modulus. Okay, they are different moduluses. Okay, so modulus of A means number of elements in set. Okay, you can write n of A or you can write, and some, okay, in some books it is also written like this, A, and there is a small o as its subscription, and they write it like 3. Okay, so you see, this is not, we do not write it this way. This has been old fashioned. We do not write it this way, we only use these two. Okay, got it? Okay, so let's move on.
Yes, sir.
Okay, guys, you see, it is impossible to find the modulus of an infinite set. If a set is an infinite set, you won't be able to find its modulus or cardinality or number of elements in it, because there is no, uncountable number of elements in it, right? Okay. Let me ask you a funny question. Suppose there is a set A, which is set of all the stars in the universe. Okay, now is it a finite set or is it an infinite set? You see,
so this is an
infinite set.
Okay, so you mean there are infinite number of stars, you cannot count the number of stars, is that what you mean?
Yes sir.
Let me ask you this. Okay, so if you open Wikipedia, you will see that it is written that there are this many trillion or whatever, okay, stars are there in this universe approximately. It is written like that, right? You see, you cannot count the number of stars in the universe because you are a kid right now. And even I cannot count the number of stars in the universe because I am a mathematics lecturer. But an astronomer, okay, who is studying astronomy, who knows about astronomy, by his scientific method, he can count the number of stars in the universe. Obviously, it is not possible that there are infinite number of stars in the universe. Okay, you can put a number on it. Star is an object. Okay, there is a finite number of stars. Okay, it is not like there are infinite number of stars. No matter how big it is, at least there are finite number of stars. Okay, at a time, at a time. You see, new stars are being born, old stars die. New stars are born, old stars die. Okay, you know that. When a star dies, it becomes a neutron star or white dwarf or black hole. You know about it, right? Okay, little bit. Okay, whatever. So you see that there are a finite number of stars, obviously. Okay, it is not like infinite
yes,
number
sir.
Of stars. Okay. Now let me write another
okay.
set. Set of all humans on Earth. It's a finite set or infinite set?
Finite.
Yes, we can count, right? We
Next
can
set.
Count. No matter how big it is, we can count. Approximately 6 billion, that is an approximate number. Still, we can, if we devote our entire life to it, we can count it. Okay. Let's move on. Okay. And so it was all about empty set, finite set, infinite set, and modulus or cardinality of a set. Okay. And now let's talk about subset. You see, subset. Let's say there are two sets, set A, which has elements 1, 2, 3, and there is another set B, which has elements 1, 2, 3, 4. Now, as you can clearly see, that each and every element of set A, okay, belongs to set B. You can see here clearly for yourself that each and every element of set A, okay, whatever element you pick from set A, 1 is there in set B, 2 is there in set B, 3 is there in set B. Each and every element of set A is there in set B. And that is the reason why I shall say A is a subset of set B. And actually, do you know what subset means? A part. You see for yourself here, A is a part of B. A is simply a part of B. Okay, you just pick some elements from set B and make a new set, and that set is A here, right? Just pick some elements of set B. 1, 2, 3, pick them and put them in curly braces. You get a new set, that is set A. A is a part of set B, right? Each and every element of set A belongs to set B. And when this situation arises, we say that A is a subset of set B. A is a subset of set B. Okay? When each and every element of set A belongs to set B, we say that A is a subset of set B. I hope you got it.
Yes, sir.
Now you see, here, each and every element of set A belongs to B. That is why I said A is a subset of B. But let's talk about the reverse. Does each and every element of set B belong to set A? Absolutely not, right?
No, sir.
Because you see, 1, 2, 3 of set B, of course, they belong to A. But what about 4, 5? They do not belong to set A, right? So each and every element of set B doesn't belong to set A. That's why I will say that B is not a subset of set B, set A. Okay. You see, symbolically, I will write it like this. A is a subset of set B. I will symbolically write like this. A is a subset of B. This is the symbol that we use to denote that A is a subset of B. And B is not a subset of C, subset of A. How we denote it? Like this. B is not a subset of A. The same symbol, just put a cross across. Okay. Got it? So this is the symbol for A subset of B. And this is the symbol for B is not a subset of A. I hope you got it, right?
Okay. Yes, sir.
Okay. So
yes,
now let's move on. Okay. So now let me give you another example. Suppose set A has elements 1, 2, 3 in it. Set B has elements 1, 2, 3 in it. As you can clearly see in this case, A, each element of A is there in B. 1, 2, 3. They are all there in B. That's why A is a subset of B. And also you can see each element of set B is also there in set A. Each element of set B is also there in set A. B is a subset of A here. So you see here, this is a special case when the two sets are subsets of each other. This is a special case that the two sets are subsets of each other. And when this case arises that the two sets are subsets of each other, we say that the two sets are equal to each other. That we say that the two sets are equal to each other. If two sets are subsets of each other, then they are equal to each other, because A carries all the elements of set B, B carries all the elements of set A. Okay, there is no element between AB which is, there is no such element exists which in there in A not in B, or which is there in B not in A. Okay, they are completely identical. Okay, so I will say that if A and B are equal to each other, if they have the exact same elements, they have the exact same elements. Remember, if they have the exact same elements, then I will say A and B, these two sets are equal to each other. Okay, and let's move on. Okay, now you see, let's talk about the first example once again. You see here, A is a subset of B because each element of A is there in B, but B is not a subset of A because each element of B is not there in set A. And this is a special case also. In this case, you see, A is a subset of B, but B is not a subset of A. And why is that? Because B has some extra elements. B has some extra elements that are not there in A. And in a case like this, we will say that A is a proper subset of B. Proper subset of B. Remember, A is a subset of B. That's granted. A is a subset of B. But we can also say that A is a proper subset of B. A is a subset of B. Is correct. Also, A is a proper subset of B. And why is that? Because A is subset of B, but B is not subset of B. That's why I will say that A is a proper subset of B. Yes.
Sir, and B is a superset of A.
Yes, yes. I will say that. Okay, you see that A is a proper subset of B because you see that A is a subset of B, but B is not a subset of B. And B is a superset of A. B is a superset of A. Remember, okay, when A is a subset of B, but B is not subset of A, in this case, we say that A is a proper subset of B and B is a superset of A. B is a superset of A. You can think about it like this, that A is just renting a room in B's house. You can see that B is the landlord and A is just renting a room in B's house. Okay, A is just a part of B. Okay, just a tiny part of B, not whole of B. Okay, remember, you see. Okay, so Venn diagram of this is like this. This is set A. You will put the circle of set A inside the circle of set B. So this says that any element of set A, any element of set A that falls within the circle of set A also falls within the circle of set B. Also falls within the circle of set B. That is, each and every element of set A also belongs to set B. So from this we can see for ourselves that A is a subset of B. And also we see here that B is not a subset of A, because there are some extra elements in set B which do not come within the circle of set. You can see here. You see here, B has a big house. This B is the landlord. B has a big house. And A is just renting a tiny room in B's house. Okay, A is just renting a tiny room in B's house. Just like B is your father and A is yourself. Okay, everything that you have comes from your father. Everything that you have comes from your father. Okay, and your father has his own things that do not belong to you. You can see, you can correlate. You can correlate it, right? Okay. So in this case, you are the proper subset of your father and your father is your superset. Okay? So let's move on. Are we clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now let's talk about equivalent sets. You see, we just talked about equal sets and what are equivalent sets then. You see, two sets A and B are equivalent if they have the same number of elements in them. A and B are equivalent to each other if they have same number of elements in them. Or you can write if mod of A is equal to mod of B. Suppose they have the same number of elements. For example, suppose A has 1, 2, 3. B has A, B, C. As you can see, A, B both have 3 elements in them, equal number of elements in them. That's why I will say that A and B are equivalent sets. Also, okay, suppose there is a set C which has elements 1, 2, 3. You see, here A and C, these two sets are equal to each other, right? Here A and C, these two sets are equal to each other. In addition to that, they are also equivalent to each other. A and C are equivalent to each other because number of element of set A is 3, which is also equal to number of element of set C. Obviously, set A, set C both have 3 elements. So can I guess from this? Can I make a conclusion from this that if two sets are equal to each other, then they are also equivalent. They are also equivalent. Definitely, they have the exact same element. So number of element of A will be equal to number of element of B. But can I say the same for the converse? Can I say that if number of element of set A is equal to number of element of set B, then can I say that A and B are equal sets? No, they may or may not be. They may or may not be. If A and B are equivalent sets, then they may or may not be equal. For example, these two sets here. They are equivalent because their number of elements same, but are they equal? No. So you see, if two sets are equivalent, then they may or may not be equal. They may be equal or they may not be equal. But if two sets are equal, then they are definitely equivalent. I hope I made myself abundantly clear, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this was all about subset and superset. So let's come to talk about the logical implication of subset. What is the logical implication of subset? You see, suppose it is given to us that A is a subset of B. Suppose it is given to us that A is a subset of B. We know it, that A is a subset of B, because each and every element of set A belongs to set B. We know it. So if I pick any random element, any arbitrary element of set A, suppose let's call it X. Let X be a random element of set A. Any arbitrary element of set A. Then I can say definitely that if X belongs to A, then this X also belongs to B, because it is given to me that A is a subset of B. If X is any random element of set A, then X also belongs to set B. Otherwise, A would not be subset of set B. but it is given to us as a subset of E. I hope you got it. Okay.
Yes sir.
Okay. So symbolically,
yes, sir.
Yes. So symbolically, we write it like this: X belongs to A. First, let me write it like this in words: X belongs to A implies that X belongs to B. For example, you see. For example, you say something to me. For example, suppose you think that I have stolen something from you. You think that I have stolen a pen from you. You think that I have stolen a pen from you. So you do not directly say that to me. You say something like that. Something like that. That is indirectly telling me that you think that I have stolen a pen from you. So I will say what you are saying implies that I have stolen from you. What you are saying implies that I have stolen from you. It means that, right? So here, X belongs to A implies that. Means that X belongs to B. And why did we know? How did we know so? Because it is given to us as a subset of B. And finally, let me remove the implies that words. Let me remove the implies that phrase and let me write it like this. X belongs to A, this symbol arrow. X belongs to B. This symbol means implies that. X belongs to A implies X belongs to B. Okay. And how do I know? Because A is a subset of B given to us. Given to us. Okay. I hope you got it.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Let me erase it. Now you see. You have been given two sets A and B. You have been given two sets and you have been asked to prove that A is a subset of B. You have to prove that A is a subset of B. And how do we go on about doing that? What is the procedure? Okay. So let me tell you, in mathematics, proving something and verifying something are entirely different. Let me tell you. You see, in mathematics, when you want to prove something, you do not prove it by giving examples. That proof will not be accepted. And let me tell you why that proof will not be accepted. You see, maybe you have proven it by giving your example. Maybe somebody will come along and he will give another example where this theory does not work. It's logical, right? In your example this is proved, but maybe I will give you another example in which I will disprove it. Got it? It's not right to conclude that this is right for everybody's example. You have to prove it, not by giving an example. Got my point? Hello? Got my point? Maybe for your example this worked. Maybe I will give you another example in which this will not work. So do not give examples to prove something. Then how do we prove it? How do we prove something? In mathematics, we prove something in two different ways. One is logically, and the other one is using already proven properties. You see, logically means I will tell you, I'll just explain it to you how. Logically, by applying logic, because you see, nobody can deny logic. Okay, logic is one thing that nobody in the universe can deny. Logic. Okay, you can apply logic, or you can use already proven properties. The properties that have already been proven, you can use those properties and prove your concept also. Okay, but when do we use examples? We use examples to verify a theory. And what is verifying? Verifying a theory means what? Verifying a theory means to check if this theory actually works. So take an example, and it is like checking. Verifying means what? Checking. You just check it that if this theory actually works. How do you check it? Take an example and check if this theory works. That's it. But proving and verifying are different. I hope you got it. Hello. Okay. So let me.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So in our question, it will be asked of you to prove that A is a subset of B. You have to prove that A is a subset of B. And how do we prove it? We will say let X be a random element of set A. Let X be a random element of set A. And we do not know anything about the elements of set A. We have no idea. We do not know anything about the elements of set A because set A is not given to us. The elements are not given to us. Just A is given to us. Set A is a set. So let us assume that X be a random element of set. A random element of set means X can be any element of set. That is, X represents each and every element of set. You can call it like that. So X belongs to set A. This is our assumption. This is our assumption that X is a random element of set A. Now, after following some steps, somehow, if I can prove that the same X also belongs to set B, logically, after following a couple of steps, if I am able to prove that this X also belongs to set B, then what did I prove? I proved that any random element of set A, which is X, also belongs to set B. If I can prove it, then what does it mean? A is a subset of B. I will just give you an example. I will prove it to you. I will give an example here. Don't worry about it. So you see, you first assume let X be a random element of set A. Then we go on to prove that the same X also belongs to set B. This you assume, this you prove. Now if you prove that X belongs to set B, then obviously A is a subset of set. So let me give an example. A question is, if A is a subset of B, B is a subset of C, then prove that A is a subset of C. A, B, C are three sets, and here it is given to us that A is a subset of B, B is a subset of C. These two things are given to us. This is given. We have to prove that in this case, A is also a subset of C. So let's just first realize this using Venn diagrams. Then we'll prove it. First, let's realize this using Venn diagram. Yes.
So we are proving this using logical way.
Yes, we have to prove it using logic. You see, before we prove it using logic, let's first realize this concept with the help of Venn diagrams. Because you see, in 11th, 12th mathematics, most of the time we use pictorial representation of our concepts to understand them fully. Okay. You see, I will draw the diagram like this. You see, A is a subset of B. That means each and every element of set A is there in set B. Okay. That's why I draw the circle of set A inside the circle of set B. Then it is also given to us that B is a subset of set C. Then I will draw the circle of set B inside another circle of set C. Because B is a subset of set C, it is given to us. These two are given to us. As you can see here, circle of A is also there inside circle of C, right? Circle of A is also there in circle of C. That is, if you pick any element of set A that also belongs to set C, because any element of set A is also lying inside the circle of set C. That is why I will say that A is a subset of C. But this was Venn diagram realization. This is not proof. You have to prove it using logic. I'll prove it. Okay, got it? I hope you got it.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay, let me erase it. And let's prove it using logic. You see, first it is given to us that A subset of B, B subset of A, these two, sorry, B subset of C, this is given to us. And we want to prove that A is a subset of C. So let's assume, or let's say X be a random element of set A. Random element, any element, right? Each and every element we are referring to here. Set A. Each and every element of say A is being referred to by X here. Okay, X is any random element of set. That means X belongs to set A. Well, it is given to us that A is a subset of B. Now, since we know that A is a subset of B, then logically this X must also belong to set B, otherwise A would not be a subset of B. It is given to us A subset of B, right? Now, it is also given to us that B is a subset of A. Now, if B, it is also given to us that B is a subset of C. It is also given to us B is a subset of C. Now, if B is a subset of C, then logically we can say that this X which belongs to B, this X also belongs to C, right? Because if X belongs to B, then X also belongs to C. Otherwise, B would not be a subset of C. Lo and behold, you already proved that any random element X of set A also belongs to set C in the last set. You proved that if X is any random element of set A, that same X also is there in set C. We do not care what element of set A, any random element, every element, got it? So that is, you proved that X belongs to A implies X belongs to C. You see, you proved that. You see, after a couple of steps, you proved it. X belongs to A implies X belongs to C. Therefore, A is a subset of C. I hope you got it.
Second last step, you wrote X belongs to A implies X belongs to C. So we can mark X belongs to A as 1 and X belongs to C as 3. And we can also say like 1 from 1 and 3, we got that A is a subset of C.
Actually, yes, actually you are right. But here, actually, we follow the standard protocol. The standard protocol is, we have to symbolically write X belongs to A implies this symbol is very important mathematics. This is related to logic, okay, implication. So you have to write it, okay. X belongs to A implies X belongs to C, therefore A is a subset of C. So let's move on, guys. Okay, so this was the story of subsets, superset and everything, and let's just talk about universal set. Let's talk about universal set. Now let's see, suppose A, B, C, D, like this, we are suppose working with suppose we are working on these sets A, B, C, D. For the timing, we are only working on A, B, C, D. No more sets for us, only A, B, C, D. We are working with only A, B, C, D. Now let us imagine a set, such a set which is a superset of all the sets that we are working with. Let us imagine a set which is a superset of all the sets that we are working with. And superset means what? That A, B, C, D, all of the sets that we are working with are proper subsets of this set. This set is drawn as a rectangle. This set is drawn as a rectangle around the sets that we are working on, and this set is called universal set. We write it as capital U, because set is given denoted by a capital letter of English alphabet. So we denote it as U. Remember, if A, B, C, D are the sets that you are working on, then imagine a set which is a superset of all these four sets. That is, you can see that A, B, C, D, they are just renting tiny, tiny rooms in the house of the universal set. In the house of the universal set. Universal set is the owner of the house, and A, B, C, D are just renting rooms. Okay? And here, A and B, they are also renting a common room also. Okay, they are also renting a room which is common to A and B both. Okay, you can see it like this. Don't worry about it. We'll talk about intersection in this shortly. So you can see here. Got it? Hello. That universal set is a
yes, sir.
Super set of all these.
Yes,
so
sir.
This is called universal set. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. So now let's see. Universal set. Let me give an example. Let's say, suppose we are working on two sets A and B. Suppose you are working on two sets A and B. Suppose you are working on two sets A and B. Now imagine a set which is a superset of both A and B. That is, it carries all the elements of set A and all the elements of set B. 1, 2, 3. As you can see, okay, you can stop right here. This is also a universal set of A and B. You can stop right here, of course. You see that universal set carries all the elements set A. A and B, they are proper subset of universal set. You can see for yourself. Got it? But you can also include some extra elements in it. It's up to you. You can also include some extra elements in it. Up to you. This is universal set. Okay, it is written, Venn diagram is written like this. This is A, and as you can see, I have made this set like this, that it is a subset of set B. So it is not the usual case. Sometimes A is sometimes A is a subset of B. Sometimes A is also not a subset of B. Let me make a usual case. Okay, so A, B. You see, let me write, this is set A, this is set B. Let me write 1 here, let me write 2 here, let me write 3 here. As you can see here, 1 belongs to set A but not set B. You can see here clearly, because 1 is there in set B. There is no element 1 in set B. 3 is there in set B but not in set A, as you can see here. And 2 is there in both set A and set B because it is a part of both circles. You can see here. And then this rectangle outside, actually it looks like a square right now, it is the universal set. And what are the elements of universal set? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. See, 1, 2, 3 already are there in universal set. What remains? 4, 5.
So
you write somewhere outside.
Yes,
you write somewhere outside 4, 5. So this is the final universal set representation. I hope you got it. Okay, so let's move.
Yes, sir.
Now let's talk about a very important thing, a very important concept. So remember, universal set will be given to you, or you can imagine it. Sometimes universal set will be given to you. Universal set will be given to you. This is the universal set. Or sometimes you can imagine the universal set. That there is a set which is a superset of all the sets that I am working on. You can imagine it for yourself. But whatever be the case, whether you imagine the set, universal set, or whether the imagined set or the universal set is given to you, in both cases, you always remember one thing, that no element exists outside universal set. It is empty. Remember, nothing exists outside the universal set, because the sets that you are working on, suppose you are working on ABC. The sets that you are working on, the elements of these sets are there in universal set. Okay, remember, Nothing exists outside the universal set. This is empty space. This is empty space. Remember this.
Yes, sir.
So I will conclude that if some element does not belong to universal set, I will conclude that if some element does not belong to, some element X does not belong to universal set, then that X does not exist. I hope you got it. Now,
yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now, if an element does not exist, if an element does not exist, where do we put that element? In empty set, right? Because empty set has no elements in it. If an element does not exist, if X does not exist, there is no such thing as X. There is no such thing as X. X is a ghost element. X is a ghost. It doesn't exist. Okay, you just believe X is a ghost. Okay, it doesn't exist. So it is a ghost, that's why it will live in what? Empty house. Got it? Hello.
Yes, sir.
Oh.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Oh.
Yes, sir.
So understand this concept. Okay. So let me erase it. Okay. Similarly, also you can imagine that if some element belongs to empty set, that means what? This element does not exist, because we know that is empty set. Then if X belongs to phi, then X does not exist at all. And if this is the case, then I can say that X does not belong to universal set, because X does not exist. What does not exist, that does not live inside the universal set, right? Right, you can conclude this from this. If some element does not exist, where will it be? If some element does not exist, if some element does not exist, because here X does not exist, X belongs to phi, means X does not exist. And if some element X does not exist, then will it belong to universal set? If it belongs to universal set, then it has to exist. Any element that belongs to universal set, it exists. But here X does not exist. That means what? X does not belong to universal set. I hope I made myself clear.
Sir, sir.
Yes.
Okay.
Sir, this will vary from question to question now, because if in one question it will be given that universal set is set of natural numbers. So if we conclude a set of element of
yes, very good, very good, very, very good. That's the thing. That let me tell you. Yes, that's why I said you just have to imagine that nothing exists outside the universal set. See, Sai's question is, this depends on the question, of course. You see, for example, in a question it is given, ki consider set of natural numbers. Set of natural numbers as universal set. Sai's question is, he consider set of natural numbers as universal set. So it is here given us in the question. I consider set of natural numbers as universal set. That means our universal set carries which elements? Natural numbers. So any number which is not a natural number, while we are solving this question, those numbers do not exist for us. Remember, while we are working on this question, nothing exists outside the universal set. That is, nothing exists outside the set of natural numbers. Okay, no number. I give you 1.2 doesn't exist for me right now, because I am working on this question. Because I am working on this question, and in my question, natural number set is everything that is the universal set. Outside this, nothing exists for me. I hope you got it.
Yes, sir.
Okay. One second. Somebody has a problem joining. One second. Okay. So everybody, okay, 9, 8 students left. I hope ki those students that those